Welcome back, future colleagues. Again, this is Professor Amr Nadim, and we are continuing in this lecture the second part of physiologic adaptation and changing during pregnancy. If you remember, in the first part, we discussed the fetal placenta unit as a hormone factory. You saw how the fetus is controlling its existence and how he is creating kind of hormonal changes in order to make his existence possible, provide the necessary nutrients and remove the metabolites, and we also review the changes in the cardiovascular system. In this part, we shall continue with the physiologic changes affecting the remainder of the body systems. So let's start this part by the respiratory system. Actually, the respiratory system has the burden of providing the extra oxygen needed by the baby and the mother, and washing out the carbon dioxide that is produced by the fetus in excess. The changes are mediated essentially by the progesterone and by the excess of the carbon dioxide that is delivered to the mother from the fetal circulation. As we previously mentioned, you need to know the anatomical changes that are essentially mediated by the mechanical effect of the diaphragm being pushed upward up to 4 centimeters by the gravid uterus at term, and by the widening of the subcostal angle and increasing the chest diameter and circumference slightly. The respiratory system needs to satisfy the 20% increase of the oxygen consumption above the non-pregnant level. 50% of this increase in the oxygen consumption is consumed by the gravid uterus and the growing baby, and the remainder is consumed by the maternal tissues. As a consequence of diaphragmatic elevation, there is a 20% reduction of the residual volume and the functional residual capacity of the lungs, together with a 5% reduction of the total lung volume. The maternal respiratory rate remains unchanged, but there is an increase of 30 to 40% in the tidal volume, secondary to an increase in the inspiratory capacity, resulting in a 30 to 40% increase in the minute ventilation. This increase in the minute ventilation is associated with some important changes in the acid-base equilibrium. Progesterone is causing an increased central chemoreceptor sensitivity to carbon dioxide, resulting in an increased ventilation and washout of the arterial PCO2. The result is a respiratory alkalosis, which is compensated by the kidney through the excretion of bicarb, leading to a normal pregnancy bicarb level and a normal unchanged arterial pH. And the minute ventilation continues to increase throughout pregnancy, associated with the increase in the oxygen uptake and the basal metabolism of the woman. So just to sum up what happens from a clinical point of view, women who are pregnant are dyspneic, and the dyspnea of pregnancy is due to the physiologic response to the low arterial PCO2, which is actually due to the increased sensitivity of the central chemoreceptor to carbon dioxide, making up the washout of the carbon dioxide and the compensated respiratory alkalosis. Also of importance are the allergy-like symptoms or the sensitivity to the chronic cold and the mucosal hyperemia associated with pregnancy, with the marked nasal stuffiness and increased amount of nasal secretions noted during pregnancy. So there remains a single slide which is actually important before concluding talk about the physiologic adaptation of the respiratory system to pregnancy. And it's related to two effects you already studied in your physiology course, that's the Bohr effect and the Haldane effect. The Bohr effect simply states that as the pH decreases, the ability of the hemoglobin to lose oxygen
will increase. That's a shift to the right of the oxygen hemoglobin dissociation curve. And as the pH increases, there is a shift to the left. The Haldane effect is related to the carbon dioxide, and it simply states that that the oxyhemoglobin has a higher affinity for carbon dioxide than the oxyhemoglobin. So as more carbon dioxide passes into the maternal blood, the carbon dioxide will decrease the maternal pH, and with this, the affinity of the adult hemoglobin for oxygen will decrease, and there is more oxygen that is made available for the baby passing into the fetal circulation. In the same time, the deoxyhemoglobin will carry more carbon dioxide by the Haldane effect. At the same time, on the fetal side of the placental membrane, there is increase in the carbon dioxide. This will increase the affinity of the fetal hemoglobin for oxygen, shifting the hemoglobin, the fetal hemoglobin oxygen dissociation curve to the left, and the deoxygenated hemoglobin will lose more carbon dioxide by the Haldane effect. So at the side of the placenta, the hemoglobin dissociation, oxygen hemoglobin dissociation curve of the adult hemoglobin is going to lose more oxygen and carry more carbon dioxide. On the other side of the placental barrier, the fetal hemoglobin will carry on more oxygen and will lose more carbon dioxide. So now shifting to the hematologic system, the changes in the hematologic system will aim to maximize oxygen delivery to the fetus and in the same time to compensate for the blood loss at the time of delivery. So you've previously seen this curve and you know already that the plasma volume will expand more than the increase in the red blood cell mass, and this will create what we usually refer to as the hemodilution or the physiologic anemia during pregnancy. It results in that the maximum rise in the plasma volume is achieved by the 32nd week of pregnancy and is reduced thereafter. So always remember that pregnancy is considered a hypercoagulable state. There is an increased risk of DVT both during pregnancy and preperium. Indeed, the risk of thromboembolism doubles during pregnancy and increases to 5.5 times the normal during preperium. Those who are going to be delivered by cesarean section have 9 times more risk of contracting thromboembolism than those who are going to be delivered via the vaginal route. The reason for which pregnancy is a hypercoagulable state is the increased concentration of tumorous clotting factors, including fibrinogen, factors 7, 8, 9, and 10. On the other hand, prostaglandin, factor 5, and factor 12 will remain unchanged. On the other hand, concentration of the inhibitors of coagulation, activated protein C and protein S, are decreased during normal pregnancy. The renal system indeed suffers from the growing uterus. Actually, pressure from the growing uterus together with the effect of the progesterone leads to dilatation of the ureter and of the kidney, creating kind of hydroureter and hydronephrosis. The effect of the progesterone on the smooth muscles of the uterus and on the muscles of the bladder leads to reduction of the bladder tone and the tone of the ureters, and this will increase the residual volume and might increase the tendency for the occurrence of urinary tract infection.
So I'd like you to retain the effect of the growing uterus on the ureters and on the pelvic LCL system and on the urinary bladder, and that this effect is more prominent on the right side than on the left side because of the dextrorotation of the uterus, that this situation might sometimes be mistaken for obstructive uropathy, and that the retained urine might lead to a kind of collection errors and leads to increased predisposition to urinary tract infection from this distention syndrome. That this distention syndrome makes the performance of elective pyelography mandatory at least 12 weeks postpartum and not before that. It's important to note that the glomerular filtration rate increases and that the renal plasma flow increases by 50%, and this will cause some kind of drop of serum creatinine and increase the clearance of protein, amino acids, and glucose excretion. As previously mentioned, the kidney compensates for the respiratory alkalosis by excreting more bicarb, and that the osmoregulation is a bit altered by decrease in the osmotic thresholds for arginine vasopressin release. The serum osmolality will decrease, and there is an increased metabolism of arginine vasopressin due to excessive vasopressinase activity, which is an enzyme expressed by the placental trophoblast during pregnancy. And this increase in the activity of the vasopressinase is related to the placental mass, so that it will increase as pregnancy progresses and in multiple pregnancy. It also increases when the vasopressinase metabolism is reduced in case of liver diseases, such conditions as hepatic dysfunction in case of acute fatty liver of pregnancy, HELLP syndrome, hepatitis, and cirrhosis, creating some sort of transient diabetes insipidus. So just to sum up, with the increase in the renal plasma flow, you should expect that the glomerular filtration rate is going to increase. There is sometimes an increase in the urinary glucose excretion, so that there might be a trace of glucose or routine prenatal calorimetric dipstick evaluation. There is no abnormality in that, and this does not denote by any means diabetes mellitus. Amino acids and water-soluble vitamins such as vitamin B12 and folate are excreted to a greater extent compared to the non-pregnant state, but there is no significant increase in urinary protein loss, and any proteinuria that occurs during pregnancy should engender consideration of it. Sodium levels remain unchanged. Indeed, sodium loss due to the increased glomerular filtration rate is compensated by increased renal tubular absorption of sodium. Also, there is an increased renal angiotensin activity, and the plasma renin increases up to 10 times the non-pregnant state. However, the non-pregnant women are actually protected from the hypertensive effect of the increased renal angiotensin, whereas women with hypertensive disease are not having such immune effect. The gastrointestinal tract is one of the systems that suffers most. The effect of pregnancy is both mechanical and functional through the effect of the progesterone on the peristalsis of the gastrointestinal tract smooth muscles. We shall consider together when we meet in the face-to-face session some of the clinical implications of the pregnancy on the gastrointestinal tract. In this slide, you can see that some of the metabolic changes occurring during pregnancy. You are going to notice that some of the placental hormones are anti-insulin, or most of them are anti-insulin, and this will increase the insulin resistance, especially starting from the second half of pregnancy. Also during pregnancy, there is increased lipolysis with free fatty acid made available for the mother to produce energy, while glucose and amino acids are shifted to the fetus. For this reason, there is a tendency to ketosis and accelerated starvation.
And for this reason, usually we are not advising women to fast during Ramadan.
So weight gain during pregnancy is an issue that is actually important for every pregnant woman. The overall weight gain during pregnancy is variable. It depends on the pre-pregnancy weight, on the body mass index, on whether we are dealing with a singleton or a multiple pregnancy. The average gain is about 12.5 kilograms, and the reason for the increase in the body weight is illustrated in this slide. Pregnant women are subject to the effect of the hormone vaccine on the capsules of the joints and the ligaments, especially the ligaments of the back anterior posterior longitudinal ligaments. And this relaxation of the supportive ligaments and capsules of the joints makes the muscles contract and enter in a sort of chronic spasm. This is causing the lady to have an altered gait, and it causes a greater joint laxity, leading to widening of the symphysis pubis, which allows for a more capacity of the pelvis for the growing uterus, and it also will affect the other joints, causing kind of arthralgia, sciatica, low back pain, and leg pain, and sometimes difficulty of breathing with the widening of the costal vertebral angle. Integrative changes are going to be discussed when we are going to meet in the face-to-face lecture. We previously noted that pregnancy leads to kind of insulin resistance due to the release of many of the anti-insulin hormones by the placenta. And this is essentially marked from the second half of pregnancy. Thyroid functions remain almost unchanged, although thyroid is producing more TIS4 and TIS3, yet there is an increased release of thyroid binding globulin by the liver, and this makes the levels of T4 and T3 practically unchanged. Adrenal functions is increased due to the stimulation of the release of ACTH by the corticotropin releasing hormone, leading to increased free plasma cortisol. I hope that by the end of this lecture, you are appreciating how the different body systems of the mother are adapted in order to solve the needs of the growing baby inside. And that these profound changes are actually leading sometimes to unnecessary medication being given to physiologic changes, and sometimes they can raise alarm to both the mother and her physician if he is not aware of the physiologic nature of such changes. By this, I am concluding my lecture, and I hope that when we are going to meet in the face-to-face, you will be ready with interesting questions. Thank you very much.